Okay, let's get started. So, congratulations everyone. You've almost made it to the end of our guest lecture series. And today, to put the icing on the cake, we have Aldo Jongejan from the group from Peggy Moorland, whose name I keep forgetting. The Center for Epidemiology, Biostatistics.
Clinical Epidemiology, Biostatistics, and Bioinformatics.
I need a little help every now and again.
Yeah.
Right, so before we get into that, two quick announcements. This has also been put on Canvas. The exam info has been updated. Nothing substantial has changed from what was already available. Just a couple things have been restructured and clarified for your benefit. The question hour discussion thread has been opened, so if you want me to discuss any questions with you next week, then now is the time to start discussing amongst yourselves. And I think that was the important stuff out of the way.
How long is it supposed to be? Like 10 pages? 1 page?
No. Keep it short, keep it simple. We don't want you to submit the proposal, we want to ask you questions about it.
So
the one page is the limit on the notes that you can bring, and that should tell you enough on how big it should be. Right? We don't expect a full draft grant proposal with a Gantt chart and the time and the budget distribution and a context for why this question must be answered now and not in a year. What we want is for you to think about an important scientific question in the field of translational bioinformatics. And we want you to come up with a combination of data sets, of statistical tools, of computational pipelines, of any component that you have seen in the 9 papers that we've gone through. And we want you to combine that in a creative way to come up with a valid approach to answer that question. So the emphasis is more on identifying what can also be done with the tools that you have now learned from studying the papers that we've given you, and then compiling that into a concrete plan. Right. One last quick announcement then is that the exam question suggestions will be closed at the end of this week. So that is Friday, somewhere afternoon, maybe midnight. So you have time to submit questions until then. Next week you will no longer have this option. So without further ado, Aldo, thanks very much for being here today. Please, tell us all you know about MBS.
Still a good question. Okay, so like Bas said, my name is Aldo Jongejan. I've been working at the bioinformatics lab in the AMC for quite some years already, I realized. To show my background, I studied chemistry in Leiden, then did my PhD in Delft at the enzymology lab. So no computational stuff in my curriculum at that time. But during my work in Delft, we tried to get some more ideas about the mechanism of a certain enzyme. And for that purpose, I not only grew the bacteria that we isolated the enzyme from in 100-liter fermenters, but also started building a model. Did some model building, molecular modeling on the computer. That was actually my first steps into the computational field. Did some quantum mechanic calculations on stuff on reaction mechanisms, did some teaching at the Hogeschool Leiden for 3 years, and then came to the AMC and started actually off with exome sequencing. They then were already busy with this paper, so I'm not directly involved in this research, but a colleague of mine was, so I heard all this. Most of the stories, and now I'm much more into RNA-seq analysis and all kinds of other bioinformatical stuff. So to say that I'm a bioinformatician, I know my way around with all the programs, I know how to do those things, do know a little bit about the statistics, but I still feel myself more of a hacker, getting everything to work, than a real bioinformatician. So. That's just the same, but anyway. So, you got all this nice paper. So I would like to start off, are there any questions? Because you did your homework, I guess. So somebody already have a question on the paper, or I saw somebody here in the front row already reading the paper just before we started. won't point any fingers or any names, I can imagine. But of course, well, this is just a kind of joke, and I will guide you a little bit through the paper. But I would like to have it really informal. You get all the slides. I have many more slides with some extra stuff and so on, but I will just give them to you. But I will encourage you to ask questions. I probably don't know all the answers, but maybe somebody else who has been really reading the paper knows the answers already, and then you can discuss. I think that's much more worthwhile for you guys. So let's start the basic thing, what we want as an academic hospital. You have the healthy person, and you have some slight changes on a DNA, or you can name it methylation, or whatever you want. And in that sense, that might lead to a change in the protein function. This is the really old traditional stuff that we did as bioinformatics group. And in this case, if you have this change in protein function, you have a kind of disease. Nowadays, we're going to methylation stuff, ChIP-seq, you name it. You can make it as intricate as you want. You have all different kinds of techniques, but basically it boils down to this fact that we have what we consider as healthy. Well, what is really healthy? We have some kind of changes somewhere. We have people that are not so healthy, and you want to see what is now the cause of these people becoming sick. So how can we identify these mutations, these alterations, these effects? So exome sequencing was really one of the main first ideas about this, when we could sequence the whole genomes. And I'm not going to go into the whole genome sequencing techniques, because I got from last year this remark that you already knew that. So I would immediately go down to this. So what you of course have is this, the fact that if you have a certain mutation that is really detrimental to a person, but the person is still alive, maybe some mutations are already lethal, and the baby is never born, so you will not see it. So rare mutations with a high effect size, these are relatively easy to pick out, and it becomes much more difficult to see some small mutations with some small effect size, and then we need GWAS studies and lots of people to sequence and lots of people to get information from and do the statistics to get this effect out, this signal out of all the noise. So this is really what exome sequencing is good at, the low-hanging fruits, one gene or one mutation, one gene, one disease approximation or idea. So if you have identified this one gene or this one mutation, then you know what is causing the effect. And nowadays, of course, people try to see some other diseases like schizophrenia or Huntington. There are many more genes involved there, so it becomes harder and harder to see what is really the cause of a disease. But in these days, when this article was published, we really thought you have one gene that is doing the damage, or one mutation that is doing the damage, and we can immediately identify the effects of this mutation. So, first things first. And we saw this time and time again. People thought, now we can do sequencing, exome sequencing. So we just throw everything in the machine, we get a lot of data out, and the bioinformatician is going to solve it for us. In the end, that didn't really quite work. And the same principle holds all over again. You need to do some proper, say, experimental design. So you need to know what you're looking at. And in this case, one of the first things you have to do with those diseases is establish a phenotype. Because if you have a population and you see all those ill people and you assign that they have kind of the same disease, but in the end it turns out not to be, you're mixing things. So you have to really make sure that you're looking at people that have the same phenotype, that have the same disease. This was the first thing that mainly in the group of Raoul Hennekamp, also from the AMC, together with a postdoc, Sergio de Souza, that they did. They established for the Nicolaides Bereidse syndrome how to look at the patients and really identify that they had this syndrome and not something else. So I'm going to show you later on some figures or some people. It's not my main expertise, but anyway. So what they saw about the Nicolaides Baraitser syndrome, it was a rare condition, but you could really pinpoint it. And it was well established. So once you have the symptoms, then you can really trace it back. It's really well recognizable. And people say, well, it has been underdiagnosed. So that was the main strength of Raoul Hennekamp, this professor at the AHC. He knows a tremendous amount of diseases by heart. It's really amazing. And he can really say, well, I see those and those typical features in a person. It must be that disease. Yeah. He has this catalog in his hand. It's amazing. So until that time, only 23 cases were known. Spread all over the globe, and the first patient at that time was already 32 years of age, no familial cases, and they had a normal karyotype. And that, what does that mean, a karyotype?
It's an overview of your chromosomes, right?
Yeah, so what is it? What is the importance of that they say it's a normal karyotype?
I guess you have 23. Chromosomes that are, yeah, they're just normal.
Yeah, so you don't see any splintering going on in the chromosomes. They're more or less intact. So what you can see, what you can deduce from this is that it's probably caused by a very small micro rearrangement. That's why you won't see it in the karyotype, or by a de novo mutation in a single gene. Because the effects are so serious, they say, well, they assume it must be a single gene. And of course, and because it doesn't, it's not present in the parents, it must be something like the developer. So this is what the patients look like. So I'm not an expert on all these kind of clinical data, but mainly what they saw, it was some mild growth retardation, severe developmental delay, sparse hair, large mouth, etc., etc. Well, now you see only the Nicolaides Baraitser patients, but if I put a lot of other patients there, you probably will see kind of the same features. So it's really difficult to deduce, is this a Nicolaides Baraitser or something else? Again, I'm not an expert, but maybe you have seen during your education some other patients and features, and you would say, well, this and the large eye or the mouth, that looks also like some other symptoms. So all those symptoms more or less have something to do sometimes with each other. So this is the progression of this one patient that is that was at that time 32 years, and you will see the development going on. So it's really something severe, but it's not lethal. So it's you can still live with it. I don't know if she's still alive yet, but I guess so. So then they decided, based upon this, that they were really capable of phenotyping those patients in the right way. They say, well, now we're going to do exome sequencing on these patients. So that culminated in the end in 2012, so already a long time ago, but the method still holds. In a paper by, again, Raoul and Sergio, but also our people, so Barbara van Schaik and Anton van Kampen were involved in that one. And a lot of other, well, you already see some Belgian names there, and some international names. So this is became later on quite important in the story, but I will come back to that. So we sequence everything on a solid machine. I don't know how aware you are of all the different types of sequencing machines. In this case, a sequence run at that time still took 3 to 5 days. 500,000 sequences, 25 billion bases, short sequences, 50 base pairs only, so nowadays you do much longer. We had, including the images, which they don't store anymore at the moment, you had about 2 to 4 terabytes, and including the images you had 105 gigabytes per run, and we had those CSFASTA and QualityFAST, basically it's a FASTQ file. Well, I guess you know everything about FASTQ. I don't have to tell you. I see some heads see nothing, some see yes, tell me. So did you have this already in the course? Mm-hmm. Looking at Bas?
Yes.
Yes? Okay, we skip it. Good. So main thing, also won't go into detail, at that time the solid was really peculiar. They had a color space sequencing. I don't know if you had it in the course, but nobody does that anymore, more or less. So everything goes via Illumina. So I will skip this as well. But it was a pain at that time. You couldn't use all the aligners that were available at that time, so you had to do some tricks and stuff. Anyway, so then we had the raw data for 4 patients at the AMC. So we had all the nucleotides, we had all the qualities to look at. We had 672,000 sequences, many, many nucleotides, and then of course the question remains, where the hell is this variant that we're looking for? So how are you going to do that? So the main thing is, over and over again, and I have had some slides in the PowerPoint that shows you all the methods that are available, but even that is really hard to keep up to date because every week there are new methods coming. So basically what you do is you can design probes. This is more on the wet lab side with some help of the bioinformaticians, but that's more or less done in exome sequencing. Of course, these are bare at the time provided by some vendors. And you do the experiment, you get all the quality files, you can do some quality control checks there. Then you do, you're going to map the reads to the reference genome, the human reference genome. You're going to look at the variants. You're going to annotate the variants, and then the basic thing is that you're going to filter the variants. And this is, for this paper, really, it talks a lot about this filtering, what they did. You, of course, can have a reference database for all ones that you know. You can have those in-house as well, if you want. And then you can also use, of course, other exomes that are available and do filtering with that. And then at the end, also very important, validation of all those genes. And that goes back more or less to the wet lab. So that's what they did. First, to show some overall statistics, you see that for those 4 patients, we have more or less the same number of reads. 160 million reads. About half were aligned to the reference genome, of which were, more 90% were about unique. A lot of unmapped reads and a lot of duplicates. So, where do the duplicates come from? Anybody? I see Bas smiling in the back. But
is it just by chance what is sequenced? So maybe something can be sequenced twice?
Not really. In the techniques, you try to really have every fragment that you have it and have it sequenced, so it's not sequenced twice. But there is, of course, to have a duplicate, something must be sequenced twice. So it ensures that you have the same fragment somewhere and that is sequenced again. But so where does this one come from?
Similar genes. So
it might be, chances are a little bit low to get really similar genes in that sense, certainly if you have 50 base pair sequencing.
Right.
But it's a nice step, and it's always confusing people that you have a lot of duplicates. You also have this in RNA-seq, you also have duplicates, you do something else with them at that time. But you should not forget the way you treat your samples. So most of the time you don't have a lot of DNA, for example, and you have to do some kind of amplification. So you're going to do PCR amplification. And that means that some fragments might be easier to duplicate than others. So you get a lot of duplication sometimes just based on the PCR bias in there. Yeah? And you can decide yourself, do I want to keep all the duplicates in? Do I want to remove them? At which state in my alignment remove them? Will I keep this information as long as possible, or will I just chuck it out in the beginning? So these are all kind of steps you have to consider in your mapping. So I haven't really in detail, because I don't think they did it at that time, but what you would do nowadays is that you would do a mapping and you would use the mapping that you have done to reconsider some parts of the mapping. So a realignment. Well, you might consider to take the duplicates in, do a realignment with all this duplicate information, and then check the duplicates out. So you use all the information that is present there. In this case, they had about 20 million duplicates, and they had a lot of sequences, a nucleotide sequence, and they aligned about a third at that time. Yeah. So it's all about information that you have. Are you going to throw away a lot of the information that you have, or do you take it along and consider it in your mapping strategy or whatever? So get the most out of your data. So basically what you end up with is something like this. You have an alignment file, and binary most of the time, because that saves a lot of hard disk space. But you can look at those alignments and you will see something like this. So this is a particular gene. And you see how the coverage is about. So, and I always find this funny, more or less, because nowadays we have this 23andMe, or you have gene panels, and people say, well, I can have a coverage of 40 times. So what does that mean, if you have a coverage of 40x? So what does it mean for you? I think in the paper it's also mentioned somewhere that they had what the coverage was. Yeah. The mean exome coverage was 40-fold. So what does that mean? Which coverage? If this was the whole genome, is 40%, was only this part covered? So you talk about coverage in this direction sometimes, and you talk about coverage in this direction, or depth of sequencing. So a mean of 40 times means that the coverage, if I draw, that the coverage would be like, on average, 40. Yeah. But of course, if you talk about a gene that has been covered 40 times, has a mean coverage of 40, so if I have a single gene here, if that coverage is mean 40, it might mean that it's covered on average 40 times. It also might be that it's like this. So the same gene, so this is 80 on 50, and that is 0. There's also a mean coverage of 40 times. Yeah. So when they do your sequencing for a 23andMe, for example, or you have a gene panel for a hospital, and they say, well, the mean coverage of your gene was 40 times, be aware that it can mean that they have only seen the first part of 80 times and the rest they haven't seen. So any mutations that would be there, you wouldn't see them. You can also see from that figure that the coverage is not homogeneous. Yes, it's never a straight line. I've never observed that. It's always, you always get those hilly things, and always in the beginning, of course, because reads only partial map to this start, it builds up like a gradient. Some parts are easier in the PCRs, for example, or you get some more reads from that, and then other parts are difficult because they are very GC reads or something like that, so you don't have probes for that part, and you get a lower coverage. And of course, this has an influence on where you going to look for variants, for example. In this case, you have a lot of reads for your variant detection, and you can do very nice statistics on that. But for example, if you go a little bit here, and I don't know the scale of this, but say that you have only 10 reads lying there, or you have 5 reads lying there, of one of which corresponds with a variant, can you do statistics? Yeah. And in that sense, you can even wonder if it's a real variant, if only one of five is a variant read, or a read having a variant, maybe it's a sequence error. So you have to be aware of this. You have to get these parameters out, and you can use all kinds of programs for that. We use more or less Picard metrics most of the time to get the overall statistics. And of course, for some things, you really have to go in depth. So basically, in the paper, they use the FAR scan to do the variant detection. Nowadays, I would use the GATK haplotype caller, which is a much better approach. But basically, it boils down to the same kind of things. You want to have a look at every position what the variants are. So FAR scan does it by having the alignments, get all the unique in that, and then we do look at the substitutions, so the SNPs, and the inserts and deletions in a different way, and we combine it again, and then we try to do some prediction on stuff, read counting and variant filtering. And then finally we get a whole list of SNPs out. Again, all these programs have their own parameters. Default, some are really hidden. As they are programmers like you and me, one programmer is a better programmer than the other. So sometimes parameters are not explained in the documents, but are there, or they are explained in the document and set to a new value, but if you look in the code, it's still in the old value. That happens. Yeah, so be aware of that as well. Of course, if you have some kind of benchmarking, that would help. Yeah. So people do that in the big labs. They have benchmark sets. They use a human genome set, and they always benchmark their new developed pipelines against that one. But sometimes you're just in the front of all the research, and you don't have this benchmark. You have to do something. So in this case, FAR scan, it says, well, at least I should have at least 8 reads covering a position. There should at least be 2 reads covering the variant, and the average quality should be 15. Well, you can, of course, discuss what kind of quality that is. Must it be on the read level, or must it be really on the base? In this case, it's on the base level. So the average quality should be 15. I don't know anymore by heart, but if this the 15 is for the variant, I guess so. But you can also make a distinction between the quality that you would like to have for the variant in the read and for the reference, or the nucleotide matching with the reference genome. You can distinguish between them. So then we have the... What's going on here? Something dropped off here. I don't know why, but I don't have to tell you, I guess, about the VGF format. We get it in the next page, but I don't really know why this is gone. But so mainly we have, this is, they call it the variant common format. So we always talk about the VGF format, but it's a little bit double. But mainly I will show you here. This is the format. So you have all kinds of information, and then you have 8 fields that are obligatory. You always have to have these, and then you can add as many fields if you want. You can even add your own ones, so it's not really a common format anymore. So people make changes in that, and that really messes up sometimes your downstream analysis. But it's a nice description here what it actually does. So you always need like a chromosome, a position. You can have the idea, so from a SNP database or something else. What was it in the reference? What do you find in your files? So this is really the alternative position or the variant. The quality, does it pass some filters? And there's some extra information, and then it goes on for every sample. So you can have one file containing every sample, and the description of how this is denoted is actually in the format field, and that can be very expensive. And these supply you with a whole range of criteria to filter your lists on. So, get back to the Nicolaides Bereitzer. This is what we saw in the files. So we have frameshift, substitutions, non-frameshift, non-synonymous, stop gain, stop loss, and we have a lot of synonymous SNPs, and then we have some SNPs that have to do with splicing. And you see that in total, we had about 19,000 genes. We had some kind of variant in, and we had about 300,000 variants that you have to filter to get back to one or a small candidate list. So that's what we did. So on the sides every time what we drop, and here's the filtering. So we filtered on the quality 1 and quality 2, and you can guess what these are. So quality 1 would mean so how many qualities could I have for a position? Think out loud.
Mapping quality?
Sorry?
Mapping quality of reads covering the genes?
Would be a good guess, but I guess as we're looking for this on position level, we only have the position of the reference. So the reads that have just the normal nucleotide there as in the reference, so they will get quality 1, and the quality 2 is the is the variant. And they should be over 40. We have a very nice tutorial we do at the UFA, and there it also says that we should take care that the quality 1, for example, should not be 0. And I see already smiles here.
Yeah.
Because if there is nothing present, it automatically gets a quality 0. So you have to know a little bit what you're doing. But this is a really stringent filter that we really want to ensure that the variants that we find, that they are really of good quality. We're really sure that this is a real variant. Yeah? And of course you can play around with this. But this was a first start. And then we said, instead of the variants of FARSCAN, we said, well, we at least want to have 3 reads covering the variant position. So we really make sure that it's not a sequence error. The variant should not be in a SNP database or the 1000 genome at that time. And you see that the version is really an older one. And this, why should we do this?
Because not everybody in the population is ill, luckily. So there's no point in looking at SNPs that are really common.
Yeah, so basically we don't expect that people which have the nucleolitis bereitzer syndrome that they are present in this database. So we want to really make sure that we're looking at novel variants, yes. And then we said, well, the fraction of reads supporting the variant should at least be higher than 25%. This has a little bit to do with this one, but we really want to we removed all the synonymous SNPs. We really said it should lead to a different amino acid. And then we used the SIFT score to throw some out. And you know what the SIFT score, what it does? I mean, you don't have to know by heart what it does, but why would we use something like this? What? Okay. No, but you haven't had this in the course? Or? Okay, good. We'll come on the next slide. So, and then we looked at some other things, that it's not in some kind of duplicated area, because that really makes it hard to like validate things, and that it was in a conserved region, so over multiple species. And then in the end, we had 280 genes, 307 variants, and that was our candidate list. And then, of course, everything depends on the wet lab and the amount of money, whether this candidate list is acceptable, yes or no. If you have a lab with a lot of money, then they say, 200, we do that for you. And in our case, probably they want a list of 10 or something like that. So back to the SIFT, and this is just an example, because basically what you want to know, because you're looking at a variant that you suppose, you're looking at exome sequencing, so it has something to do also with the proteins. So there must be some alteration of the protein. So we looked at the non-synonymous SNPs, so they're changing, they bring about a change in amino acids, and it of course has something to do with protein structure. So you want to have an idea, some kind of prediction tool to see what it does or what is predicted to do to the protein structure. And SIFT is one of those, and it's actually sorting tolerant mutations from intolerant. And it does that based on alignments of this particular stretch and see what is acceptable in nature. So you see sometimes in nature that some of those changes are acceptable. Okay? If you do, I have a very nice presentation about, for example, GPCRs, and you see in that certain stretches, they are very homologous, but certain positions, it's allowed to have all kinds of different amino acids. So that gives you a kind of idea what is accepted by nature and what is not. Okay? For these GPCRs, you see in the position in one of the helices, that is an arginine. If you mutate that one, you have no functional GPCR. There's no GPCR known that has something else than an arginine on that position. So you know that everything else is not acceptable. So if you then find a variant that brings about this mutation from an arginine to something else, you can predict that it does damage to your protein. So basically, that is what they use the SIFT procedure for. So it predicts a variant to affect the protein function. And you can say, well, this amino acid is detrimental, or maybe probably detrimental, or it's benign, so it's accepted. And of course, SIFT is one of the many programs, and I listed a couple here, and probably there exist many more, and they use all kinds of different methods. So there, you will see that there, some of them use sequence homology, some use neural networks, vector machines, whatever, and this is where the bioinformatics bioinformatician really comes in. So, but there's a whole range of these kind of methods, and even methods that combine all these methods again in some kind of meta score, and you can use that. And I will not go into detail in this. So this is what we ended up with, a nice list of genes, and then three more genes were added, because some people had some ideas that they should be in the list as well. They knew from literature, or they suspected something based on literature. But none of these genes could be confirmed, and you also, in a quick glance, see that SMARCA2 is not in there. So, with hindsight, you can say we missed it. And this is actually what where the Belgians came in, because we couldn't find something. And then Raoul, with his connections, he became aware that in Leuven they actually had similar patients. And also in England they were doing some kind of things, but the Leuven, they had already sequenced them, and they said, well, let's join forces. And so we did that, and then the SMARCA2 actually was identified in 8 out of the 10 patients. And this was long going back and forth, because why did we miss it? So probably somewhere in the filtering step, we put something too stringent. And of course, yeah, this is playing. Yeah, this is really hard. If you know by hindsight, yeah, you know that the SMARCA2 gene is it, then yeah, then it's easy. Actually, at the UFA tutorial, what they do, some students, they think they're clever, and they design, in the end, they get the whole variant list, and then they may design in R or something else a script to identify or to boil down the small variant list. And some people say, well, I just grab for SMARCA2, and that's my my downstream analysis function. Well, that's not the way it's supposed to work, of course. So in the end, the SMARCA2 was identified and was present in 8 out of the 10 patients. So this is also something you have to be aware of, that you will not, most of the time, not find it in 100% of the patients back. So then, of course, the validation remained. 44 patients, 10 patients sequenced, 8 were affected. They did a summer sequencing of 34 patients. And they saw a lot of mutations in the SMARCA2 gene, and there were 8 patients actually without mutations there. So something else is going on there. They summer sequenced the exons 15 to 25. It's a lot of work. And they also tried to confirm it in case they had trios, and this is where the experimental design always comes in. It's very good to have trios, that eases your sequencing a lot, or your validation a lot. and that was not always available. So, but we learned that later on. And in some cases, they could see that that the parents indeed didn't have this mutation. The second validation was that we used some in-house genomes that we already had available and see whether this mutation was also present in those. And it's basically the same as with the SNP database that you use. You want to make sure that this is something novel for this particular disease. And then we also compared it to the genome of the Netherlands data, because Barbara had been heavily involved in that. She analyzed about one third of this data, and that's a very big consortium that we had about 750 patients there. That was sequenced in China. Actually, I still remember Barbara carrying a whole lot of hard disk to the Surfsara in those big shopping bags, because that was the fastest way to transfer the data. So we validated. So it was checked in more than 200 individuals. There were some variants found, of which 8 of them were already known in the public databases or in the SNP databases, so they couldn't be the cause of this Nicolaides Doreitzer. And 2 were novel, but not in this particular part of the gene, and none of the Nicolaides Doreitzer mutations were present. So 8 patients didn't have this. All the other exons were sequenced. No mutation were found. There were no phenotypic differences were found. And then the uncertainty about the phenotyping, about the diagnosis, of course, comes into play. So this is the final table. Well, I guess you have looked at it. Maybe you have some questions about it as well. In the beginning, they sorted the groups in 2, or all the patients into 2, and they could assign 37 from the 44 into a group 1 with a high certainty of having this Nicolaides Doreitzer, and 7 into in another group with a low certainty of having Nicolaides Doreitzer, and these are really the patients that you could not identify. So I'm actually waiting for a question, which I don't know the answer of, but nobody has it, I guess. No? Okay. Nothing strange between 37 and 36 and so on?
Yes.
Okay. You have any idea? It started me wondering. I mean, I couldn't place it more or less that you have 37 in high certainty, and here it only says 36. I would expect there to have 37 then.
But the high certainty is not based on having a mutation that was only known afterwards.
Yeah.
So there is one with high certainty without a mutation.
Okay. That might be. Yeah. Okay. Sorry?
The
36
is the common sum.
The
36 is the common sum, the 37 is the low sum. So there are 37 cases with high certainty.
Yeah.
34 of which have an also known as smart mutation. 3 of which do not have one.
Mm-hmm. That's these. Yeah. No. And there you have it, 37. No. So back to the SMARCA2, where it was involved in. Well, it has something, you could have read that in the paper. It is really involved in, it's a regulator of chromatin, so it has to do with transcription and making genes available for transcription. And that is, of course, the regulation part. So I will not dwell into that too much because it's already time. But you can imagine that it has... Why doesn't that work? That's funny. So what you see, and there's that is all related into this ATPase region, so that's really involved in the catalytic part of it, and that's where all the mutations that that were involved that they saw. And it is part of a BMR associated factor complex involved in the gene regulation. So you have those mutations, it's still there, it can still bind something, but it's not functional anymore. So that is basically what it boils down to. And of course you have some limitations of this. There might be the fact that in your exome sequencing, because you have to design probes, that actually the causative gene is not present in those, in this whole panel. That might be an issue. So you have to design probes yourself. People actually in the gene panel set, so that they have for a particular disease, they make a whole panel of those specific genes. They really take care that they design very good probes so that you really see everything of the gene at more or less the same depth. But that is of course not the case in the, when you buy, for example, from Wimbledon or some of the other companies, buy such an exome probe set. Then of course you have the fact that you don't have enough coverage, or you cannot identify it correctly, etc., etc. And this is actually what happened to in our case, and due to the collaboration with the Belgian people, we could still identify this marker to gene. So that was what I had to tell. I don't know if there are any questions.
Did you pinpoint where in the filtering process you lost the smart tool?
I did not, and I really have to, I was expecting this question, and I really had to think hard where we lost it. I think we lost it somewhere at the stringent quality filters that we set.
The first one.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. And of course, what also is described in the paper that some of the variants we said we should be present in 3 out of 4 patients. So that you also could see that if you have 10 patients and it's present in 8 out of 10, if they're in the Belgian people all have it, then in the Dutch people 2 out of 4 might have missed it, and then you would just below the threshold. So, but this is really, I didn't have the data from that available anymore, but I will put it down the next time where we really lost it. But this is, yeah, some of the things that can happen. So most of the time what I did with all those projects was really give the whole list to see in how many it was present, and just start off with a bigger, say, bigger list. Yeah.
Did you try to look for the cause of the disease in the patients that didn't have the SMARCA2 mutation?
No. I can't remember that, whether they did that. It's always difficult, but I mean, in this case, you will probably, or most of the time, always see that in this kind of syndromes that you can pinpoint in a certain percentage of the patients, but not in all. So in one or two of the patients, then sometimes something else is going wrong, or it's higher upstream in some kind of gene pathway. And that's really difficult to see, yeah. And this is also the problem with those more complex diseases where there are many more genes involved. So this is really the low hanging fruit, and you really are in a way lucky, and it's the most easiest thing to do. But the more and more genes are involved or pathways are involved, it's becoming harder and harder. Yeah. So I can, for example, I had been working with Raoul for a long time, and we have this, it was called the Pierpont syndrome, and they had 4 independent patients, and I did the sequencing and I came up with one variant, or one mutations in one gene on one position, the same position. And I said, well, this must be the variant, and then Raoul said, no, it cannot be. The coincidence is too big, it's not possible. You did something wrong, and then they put it on the shelf for 2 years, and then 2 years later there was an English group and they actually found the same mutation, and we had a back-to-back paper on that one. So sometimes you're hampered by, well, it doesn't make sense. Hey? The chances that it's really the one position for such a are really low in that sense for independent patients. But sometimes that just happens. Yeah.
Do you think maybe the quality of your findings are you would have found more the same thing in more patients if you would use more current sequencing techniques?
The simple answer is yes. I think that nowadays, the sequencing techniques have become a lot better. You already saw that, for example, we did 50 base pair sequencing. Nowadays you do 100 to 200, you do paired end. It becomes a lot cheaper, so that also helps, so you can sequence deeper. And one of the main things is that at that time you used exome sequencing, so you're only looking at 3% of the genome. So nowadays you would do genome sequencing. So you would pick up a whole lot of other things. Of course, for the low-hanging fruits, that the real severe things that have to do with a mutation or alteration in a protein, exome sequencing is still okay, because it's the exome you're sequencing. But for other things, more complicated things, you would like to have the whole genome. So maybe there's some splicing going on. We have junk DNA, but it's still in our genome, so there is a reason why we have it. So I know definitely. If we could do this now, we would do it in a different way. We would make sure that we have trios from everything, etc., etc. We do a whole genome.
All right. If there's no more questions for Aldo, let's thank the speaker again.